Hi, David. This is your wife, the woman that you married. And happy Father's Day to you. It's kind of weird to talk to you like this, but I'm looking at Hazel, and it all started, well, with us. So I think I should back up just a little bit and talk about how wonderful of a dad you are. When Hazel was born and she was in ICU, you got to change her diaper first, you fed her first, you held her first, and you are an amazing dad. And then came Evan at the hospital at 11 because we stopped to get the Scrabble board. Oops. He was delivered at noon. And there we were, parents with two little kids. And you have been an amazing father. You have sacrificed so much for them when we have hit various blimps. Can we edit that part?
Yes.
Okay. When we have hit various roadblocks, you have always stepped up. Sitting on the swings at Tonawanda, where you came to numerous Boy Scout activities with Evan and took Hazel swinging in baseball practice and basketball practice and all the rugby games. Oh my gosh. They could not ask for a better dad. You have been amazing to them. And when it came time to sacrifice so that Hazel could graduate from high school, from the school that she had gone to for 3 years and finish with rugby, you did it. Broke your heart, but you left and you went to Boston without us. And you've been just amazing. And 2 years later, when Evan and I needed to stay put, you did it again. You always put your family first. You have sacrificed time and time again for us. And I know we are all looking forward to the time that we can be together. From crazy movies to cards to New Year's Eve playing Monopoly when Hazel cheats, of course.
And cheat.
And all of the fun things we did, apple picking, train riding, sledding, all the wondrous things that we have done together. You are an amazing father. And you can never doubt that you are loved because your children love you so much. And even though it's been 27 years ago when you met me and I was wearing this dress, which, by the way, I can still wear, and shoes much like I have on now, you married me anyway. Together we have built this amazing life built on trust and love. And I love you so much, and I'm still in love with you. After almost 23 years of marriage, I still love you. And happy Father's Day. And you must have done something right, because look what your daughter did for you. This was all Hazel. So, I love you. Mwah, mwah.
Is there anything else you want to say?
And Hazel gave me a minute to collect myself and asked me if there was anything else that I wanted to say. And there was. I was still right about that Howlin' Wolf tape, and you were wrong. So there.
Hey David, this is Chris, and
hi David, this is Ian.
So from two fathers to yourself, Hazel wanted us to wish you a happy Father's Day and hope you have a great time.
I'm so glad that I'm working a team led by a great father. You are a true inspiration to all of us because you are a wisdom and a patient father, and happy Father's Day.
What he said. Thanks.
Hey David, so Hazel asked me to do a little video, talk about what you mean to me and, you know, why we love you, which is a bit of a mystery. And I was thinking about some of our adventures together, you know, like the time the lady dropped us off in the floodwaters up to our waist, and we're 9 and 10, you're like, have fun walking home, don't get swept off in the floodwater. Of course we did.
I don't see you anymore.
You know, I hope you can hear I got the Billy Joel going. I had a choice between this, just the way you are, or she's always a lady. She's always a woman. I figure hashtag is a little bit better. A little bit better choice, maybe. But anyway, two stories I'll like to share. We live in Fort Rucker, and Dad would make diving weights to melt lead and make these weights, and then put them out to school outside like a pie on a windowsill. And of course, a stupid 8-year-old me, I just couldn't resist the temptation to go in there and shine. It burnt my finger. And you're all, well, it couldn't have been that hot, could it? You're like, so it is that hot. And of course, we ended up with matching burns on our fingers. It was a lot of fun. A couple years later, we're in Galveston. We talked to the postman and gave you his can of pepper spray for the dogs. And we are riding our bicycles to the spinning mart. And you fall down. Oh, you fall down and you burn. Oh, my God. Oh, it burns. It burns. Total ecstasy scene. And I'm like, what is it? Yeah, it turns out you decided I could spray the pepper spray and just ride my bike to the cloud and old Bill, like jerk back there, he'll get it good. Not so much. Another one of my favorite memories of all time is in Fort McClellan, Alabama. We were in basic training. We've been separated for Independence Day, July 4th, 1988. We had a big picnic, and all the units were taken out there to celebrate the Independence Day. And we found each other pretty quickly and spent the day together. I don't remember much other than I'm pretty sure I annoyed the people at the fireworks show by oohing and aahing, maybe an hour or two early, you know, whatever. And the last memory I think is crucial is when we were in college and you had met some really annoying girl. She was really into you, apparently, for some reason. I love you just. And you were oblivious to it. I had gotten some orchestra tickets, and I didn't want to go. But I had to have an excuse why I didn't go. I wasn't going to ask, how was the orchestra? I said, hey, David, why don't you take these orchestra tickets and ask that old girl, that tacky, obnoxious girl, to your out to the orchestra? And you did, and she said yes, and you had a good time, and I guess, as things worked out, I could take some of the credit, at least, for having to say Happy Father's Day. I love you. It's an honor to call you my brother. And have a great day. And we love you. Come see us. Something. Bye.
Hi, David. Happy Father's Day. I just wanted to start by saying that I feel so lucky to be your little sister, especially in our crazy family dynamic. I'm also so grateful that you had Hazel and Evan around the same time that I was born. It has been really interesting, but also fun growing up with my niece and nephew. You have raised some amazing kids, and I think that their characteristics that they have attained are just a true testament to the amazing father that you have been to them. You are so hardworking, you're selfless, you're loving, you're caring, you're all around just a great person, and that's the most important thing that someone can be. I'm so thankful for all the math advice you've given me over the years and all the memories we've all made together in Montana, Wisconsin, and Texas. Without you, we wouldn't have been able to know Della and her family, Hazel and Evan, and all the extensions of them. I'm so happy that you are my brother, and I hope you have an amazing Father's Day. I love you!
So why do I love Dad? As Uncle Billy says in this video, it's kind of a mystery. It's a joke. It's humor. I'm a big fan of Calvin and Hobbes, right? And there's one storyline in Calvin and Hobbes where his family's house is broken into, and there's a very sad conversation that the adults have after, like, the parents of Calvin have after the break-in, and the father says that he wishes he had known as a kid that what adults do is basically just ad-libbing. Oh, that's unfortunate. I know where it is, though. And I think part of why I love Dad is he does a good job of making it look like he's not ad-libbing. Just in general. What are some good memories I have of Dad? Well, we used to go to Chuck E. Cheese's, frankly, way too much, both for like monetary and nutritional reasons. And we used to play this game, Maze of Kings, or as I called it back when I, you know, called everything by the most bland possible name, the Egypt game. due to my overriding obsession with ancient Egypt. And Dad humored me, despite the fact that my motor skills and hand-eye coordination, and frankly, ability to process what was going on was questionable at best. And Dad, he's always been a good teammate in general. And, oh God, really hope to think of a third thing to say. And another thing that's nice about Dad, as you can see, I've teleported, is that it's nice to have someone who I can talk to about strange things that I'm interested in. And someone who, I don't know, has always been very supportive of my interests. And has also helped me develop my interest. Like one time, I went to Cunimutual, Dad's favorite company, for the take your son to work day. And all day, I'd be like, Dad, give me an equation. Sounding, write me an equation. He'd be like, solve it. I'd be okay. And I spent like hours and hours and hours doing this. And I really admire his unflagging endurance in humoring me this much. But I don't think it's just humoring me, because really what I love about Dad is that he really cares, you know? He doesn't just, like, grin and bear it. He does it because it really matters to him, even the little things. I love you, Dad. Happy Father's Day. It's beautiful.
Happy Father's Day! Hey, Uncle David, we hope you're doing all right. Hope you're having a great day. It's been way too long since we've all seen each other, so we're definitely going to have to stop talking about it and get together soon. We love you, and again, happy Father's Day.
Hi, David. I just wanted to say a few things about you from my perspective. First of all, I want to talk to you about things that happened before you came into this world. I was a general dental officer at Fort Rucker, Alabama, when we decided, when your mom and I decided to start a family. Stephen was born, and we were just thrilled. We loved him very much. He was a very good baby, and we really enjoyed having a child. So when we got, when I went back to medical school in Galveston, we decided to have another child, and so Bill was born. And we thought that was twice as good having two. And after Bill was just a few months old, we said, you know what? If two are good, three would be even better. So you were very much planned. All three of you were very much planned. And you were, as you know, you were born just a little over a year after Bill. There's a couple of things that we should have learned about you from ice cream. One we did learn and one we didn't quite learn. The first one was we learned about your sensitivity, which I'm sure you got from me. You were just a toddler and we served ice cream to the three of you and your brothers were gobbling it up. You were kind of tearing. You really weren't making good use of your ice cream. It was beginning to melt and so forth. And so I don't remember if it was myself or if it was your mom, but one or both of us said, eat your ice cream, David. And you started crying because you thought we were criticizing you. We weren't criticizing you. Of course, we just wanted you to enjoy your ice cream before it melted. So ice cream offered another lesson to us, but we didn't really quite pick up on it. One day when you three guys, and I'm sure your mom and I had some ice cream, we gave you the last serving, which was in a plastic, one of those plastic half-gallon containers, clear plastic half-gallon containers. And during the process of eating your ice cream, you actually fell asleep and we found you with your face and head in the bucket. And we had a hard time waking you up to get you to finish your ice cream. So we had a lesson there that we didn't pick up on. We should have, you know, figured out maybe that you had a sleep disorder or a consciousness disorder, which was obviously diagnosed later in life. So ice cream was something that you used to, that was used to give us two messages, one of which we picked up on, one of which we failed to pick up on. So we loved having you three guys. You were a great blessing to us. You all went on to grow up. And if you had no other contributions in life, just the fact that you furnished half the genetic material for Hazel and Evan would be enough to make your life full of great accomplishments. Two wonderful, wonderful young adults. I've always appreciated the fact that you were a good boy. You were kind and considerate, and you have a very generous spirit, and you're a very lovable person, and you show a lot of love to people around you. And that's the fact that you have super intellectual powers is wonderful, but you're not responsible for those. You didn't create those intellectual powers. I'm thankful that you got them, but you didn't create them. But what you have done is continued to be a kind and nice and generous person, and you're very much loved by your family, by me, and by all of your family. And I just want to wish you a happy Father's Day. Your production as a father has been spectacular. And we just wish you continued success and that hope that you're able to maintain your wonderful characteristics throughout your life. We love you very much. Bye-bye.
Hey, Dad. So this year for Father's Day, you know, I was thinking of what I could do, what I could get for you, since, you know, it's hard to top the orange T-Rex pinata that I got you for Christmas. And, you know, I've heard you say to Mom multiple times that you feel like you've missed out on Evan and my life since you moved to Boston. And, you know, you're wrong. Like, every time I think about that, I think of all of the things that you have been here for. You know, like, Evan and I don't really care about our proms, you know, whatever, and stuff like that. And, like, you've been here for all of our graduations. You were here when we learned how to, like, ride our bikes. You've been here for everything. You've been here for all the times when we've, like, made stir fry. You know, Evan and I did it once without you, and it just wasn't the same. You've just been here for everything. And like, you were here when I was in preschool and Jeremy asked me to marry him. And I think that it's easy to lose track of all of the years that you have been here because, you know, you're away now and you feel like you don't get to experience everything with us as we, you know, go through our lives. But, you know, I'm so grateful for the year that I was in Vermont when I got to see you, you know, like every 6 weeks and, you know, all the time together. And I liked, you know, going out in Burlington or Boston and, you know, like trying new things and like seeing different parts of each city. But my favorite thing to do with you is to just sit, you know, chill out and like watch, you know, a horrible or, you know, maybe actually good TV show or movie with you and just talk, and like if it's a bad TV show, just like rip it to shreds with you. And you're just, I feel so lucky, and I think about this all the time about how lucky Evan and I are to have a dad who's also like our best friend. And you know, you said during this trip while you're here that, you know, that's not always a good thing, that, you know, sometimes you feel like you shouldn't be our best friend. And yeah, that's true, but I mean, I joke with my friends all the time, like, I don't have daddy issues. Like, I, you know, I'm one of the few. But it's true, because you are one of the kindest, most compassionate, funniest people I know, and it's so wonderful to me that I get to spend so much time with you, and that, you know, it's not, like, weird or uncomfortable to hang out with my dad. It's something that I love to do, and it's something that I miss very much when you're away. But I look forward to, and I, you know, I may act moody when you're home, but I'm sorry. But I do genuinely love our time together, and I'm just so grateful for you. And, you know, I wanted to remind you, you know, how much people love you and how great you are and the impact that you've had on people, because you're just such a great person. And I think that you lose sight of it sometimes when you're like caught up in, you know, things going on or whatever, the fact that you're not always here. And so I hope that, you know, I did a good job. And I hope that, you know, no one spoiled it for you. I don't think anyone did, but I love you, and I'm so lucky to have you as my dad, and you're just such a great person. And I did this, and I like reached out to all these people because I wanted you to be able to like look back and watch this whenever you feel upset or whatever, because you've been here for everything. You've been here for everyone, and I love you, Dad. And yeah. Hello again. I realized I didn't share some of my favorite memories with you, so here we go. I think one of my favorite memories of you is when you met my ex, Zach, and he came to our hotel to pick me up. It was for Thanksgiving, and him and I were going to his dad's lake house in Cape Cod. And he walks into the room to pick me up, and you're just sitting in the corner in this chair, all tense. And it was so funny to me because you're like the goofiest person, but you know, you've never, you know, I didn't have any serious relationships or whatever in high school or anything. So this was like your first time of like getting to be the tough dad. And you just like said like three words to him. He was like, "Hi, Mr. Clark, you know, I'm Zach, whatever." And you were like, "Hello. How long are you going to be gone? What are you guys going to be doing?" And he was scared out of his mind the whole drive to the Cape Cod. He was like, "Your dad hates me, Hazel." He like, and I don't know. I just love that. And Evan was the same way too. Evan said like two words to him. And you know, I love every time you bake. I loved growing up when you and I would do the baking competitions in Elm Grove Park for 4th of July. I would always make cakes, and you know, the first couple of years I cheated. I used cake mix, and the judges were like, "This is so amazing. Like, you would be such a good baker." And little, like, you know, 10-year-old or whatever me was like, "Ha ha, bamboozled again." I used cake mix, but I didn't tell them that. And you would make pies. And I remember recently, it was within the last year, you tried to make a pie. You did something wrong, and the filling was essentially soup. It was still good, but it was essentially soup. And you were just so disappointed. You were like, "What is this?" And it reminds me of when Evan used to make brownies all the time. And you know, sometimes you would mix up key ingredients, and you know, sometimes they'd turn out perfect. And sometimes we'd be like, "What? How can you mess up brownie mix?" And what else? I don't know. I just, you always give us like lots of laughter and, you know, joy. And also when you were here, when you were sitting on the couch and it was like getting late at night and we were watching something, and all of a sudden I look over and you just start leaning over because you're so tired, and I push you up so you're sitting upright, and then you just fall forward on your lap and fall asleep. You just always bring so much joy and happiness and love wherever you are, and I don't want to get emotional again, but I love you, and can't wait to see you sob like a little baby when you watch this. And you're just the best father I could ever ask for. So thank you, Dad. I love you.
Through town, just my boy and me, with a Happy Meal in his booster seat, knowing that he couldn't have the toy till his nuggets were gone. A green traffic light turned straight to red. I hit my brakes and mumbled under my breath. His fries went a-flying and his orange drink covered his lap. Well, in my 4-year-old said a 4-letter word. It started with S, and I was concerned. So I said, "Son, now where'd you learn
to talk like that. He said, I've been watching you, Dad, ain't that cool? I'm your buckaroo, I wanna be like you and eat all my food and grow as tall as you are. We got cowboy boots and camo pants, yeah, we're just alike, hey, ain't we, Dad? I wanna do everything you do. So I've been watching you. We got back home and I went to the barn. I bowed my head and I prayed real hard. Said, Lord, please help me help my stupid self. The next side of bedtime later that night, turning on my son Scooby-Doo night light. He crawled out of bed and he got down on his knees. He closed his little eyes, folded his little hands, spoke to God like he was talking to a friend. And I said, son, now where'd you learn to pray like that? He said, I've been a Dad, ain't that cool? I'm your buckaroo. I wanna be like you and eat all my food and grow as tall as you are. We like fixing things and holding mama's hand. Yeah, we're just alike. Hey, ain't we, Dad? I wanna do everything you do. So I've been watching you. Eyes, I wrapped him in a hook, said my little bear is growing up. And he said, but when I'm big, I'll still know what to do. Cause I've been watching you, Dad, ain't that cool? I'm your buckaroo, I wanna be like you and eat all my food and grow as tall as you are. By then I'll be strong as Superman. We'll be just alike, hey, won't we, Dad? When I can do everything you do. Cause I've been watching you. Hey,
welcome by that place from 3 minutes ago. The guy in the street yells, hey everybody, look, it's Jesus Christ.
Take it in.
Oh, this has gotta be good. complain about.
Productive.